Yeah.
Or department or other OCC personnel. Under police commission rules of order, during public comment, neither police or OCC personnel nor commissioners are required to respond to questions presented by the public, but may provide a brief response. Individual commissioners and police and OCC personnel should refrain, however, from entering into any debates or discussion with speakers during public comment. Please limit your comments to 3 minutes.
Thank you. General public comment.
Good evening. One quick point. Is your general meltdown nationwide in police departments? Is your general meltdown San Francisco, New York's facing a massive breast tumor. Charleston, South Carolina shoots an unarmed black male 8 times in the back. Florida, police corruption. What is going on? Is technology catching up with police? Now they can't get away with it because someone's wearing a body cam. But we need those fast. Next, taser. I'm going to go one more time at this. Okay, I heard what that gentleman said a few weeks ago. Every department in a major department in this country has them, except two. One is San Francisco. One is San Francisco. They're all around us. Oakland, Mark, San Mateo. When's the last time you've heard of someone getting killed by a taser?
Oh, many times.
No, recently.
Yeah, we all got to follow the rules of order. I'm glad you get your 3 minutes.
Yeah, there has not been a man killed by a taser in San Francisco general area.
What about Illinois?
We're talking about the Bay Area. We're talking about the Bay Area. Yes, there's going to be sporadic cases like that. As I said before, taser meeting before you shoot that bullet. Yes, Native Americans will get tased more than white people. But a brother can take a shot, he can't take a bullet. Have a good evening.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening, Commissioner, President of the Office, Commissioners, Director Hicks, Sergeant Plushoff, Chief Sir. Good evening. Todd mentioned the badge cams. I know a couple of weeks ago when I was here, there was going to be a closed session. We were going to get an update on how the socialization of the new policy with the labor or the negotiation of the policy. I don't know all the details, but can we get an update as to how that went? Because the whole goal, I think, was to get the gentleman who was in charge of that project moving quickly, please. The sooner the better. It's already been over 3 years since the idea of the badge cams first came to this commission. 3 years is a long time, even in the government. Okay, that's number one. Number two, I know you probably have heard, because the president's office has quoted in the article that's in today's Chronicle about the commission, the Lewis Commission's findings that hasn't been fully released, but the summary findings were released saying that there is no accountability in San Francisco Police Department. Now, we know there's been a lack of transparency because of the lack of badge cams and other problems, but the accountability issue really isn't going to be helped much by the badge cams. If you don't do your job, which is when people do wrong, they're punished. They're not rewarded. It's not swept under the carpet. When people do wrong, even if they're the chief, no matter who they are, they need to be punished by you, and they need not to get away with it. The Police Officers Association is at the root of the problem, as we all know. Limbert, you know Chuck Limbert, former lieutenant, promoted to lieutenant a few years ago. Chuck Limbert, he was one of the officers in the Police Officers Association back before he met up with me. And he was acting as the treasurer, and he, of course, was forced out of the police department under a cloud of scandal. Now, getting to the text, it wouldn't be such a problem if the texter was the only person involved each time we find them, or if all they were doing was texting. But every time we have a texting scandal, there's usually about 15 or 20 other people in the department that are caught up in it as well. And there's usually other crimes that led to the texting scandal being exposed by these officers that are involved. That is what is so troubling to the public. If we have a bad apple here or there, it's not that big of a deal. When you have whole branches of the trees that are rotten to the core, that is what is troubling to the public. Finally, I note that Chief Suhr has the support of people ranging from David Campos to the mayor. If you can get that wide of support in body politics, San Francisco, that says you have a lot of support within the body politic. But in contrast, his support in the public is not nearly as high. That's a sign of rot within the body politic. That's a sign of corruption.
Right.
Thank you, Hamdi.
Thank you.
Oh, don't worry.
Good evening, Commissioner. I'd like to begin my commentary tonight by applauding Supervisor Jane Kim for taking a stand along the other supervisors for the police. That is literally echoing what the people have been demanding for months and serve.
Right.
Tonight, I want to focus my attention slightly away from that issue, though, because of the urgent nature of the use of force policy deliberations that are going on, and specifically referencing the Department of Justice recommendations that were just released. I want to say that we are grateful that rationally the Department of Justice has rejected suggestions by the POA to soften the language and has requested the use of shall as opposed to should. There's no accountability in a policy that just suggests things that the force shows absolutely no history of adhering to. However, I want to take particular exception with the Department of Justice's position that they have taken on the draft policy concerning conducted energy devices, aka tasers. And the exception that I wish to take with it is twofold. First off, despite the fact that the Department of Justice has not explicitly called for the use of tasers to be included in a policy, we take their suggestion that the policy be combined as one policy as not just something that would be rationally sound for the department, but as a passive endorsement of the inclusion of tasers in the policy, and reject that completely. Secondly, I'd like to point out that in their commentary on Section E, special considerations, specifically comment number 21, they say, what, if any, evidence supports the notion that homeless individuals may be more susceptible to an adverse reaction if a CED is used on them? However, the word homeless does not appear anywhere in the draft policy, which is evidence of the Department of Justice's implicit assertion that they believe it's okay to use tasers on homeless people, which is an assertion we the people reject in its entirety. And this is exactly the kind of bigotry, exactly the kind of discriminative behavior as evinced by the scandal of Sergeant Kapinski earlier in the week that we are opposed to, and it's exactly why tasers present such a dangerous option for the San Francisco Police Department with its current culture, and it is imperative that to disclude conducted energy devices from these use of force deliberations.
One is the U.S. Department of Justice was unequivocal that they are not recommending that San Francisco adopt tasers. They're not recommending it, nor are they not recommending it. That's a local decision, so I want to clarify that. The second thing is there was a stakeholder comment brought by the Coalition on Homelessness that we as a commission might want to consider adding homeless population as a group that might be more vulnerable. So they were responding to that comment. So I know that it's somewhat tricky to see the comments back and forth because we've gotten so much feedback, but I didn't want you to be left with that the takeaway was that DOJ came up with that, the local suggestion, and they were posing a question. So the other thing I want to say is that we will be having this as an item on the agenda later on down the road, and there will be an opportunity for public comment. So this is general public comment on anything not on the agenda. But so that's it. Thank you
very much.
Ms. Anita Sadi from co-director of Eagleston Foundation, and I'm also a veteran of the union and working with the union. I want to request on some of the baby was taken. There were concerns about what's been happening in the last text message, where a white officer, again, is expressing that he joined the department to kill, and he got taken away. And people in my building, a senior building at Armstrong Place, I expressed in fear. The last 2%, Black Orange, who also very active in the community, expressed terror. This is not the first time. Some of you will remember Commissioner Wong, when the video, SFPD video tapes were released during the square groups being captured with you. The beating of children on MLK Day in 2002 by police, and now with a certain story, who is one of the killers of Palestinian, and this individual working in the video. This is terrifying. We do not feel safe. Something has to be done. You come back, you know, as a group, as a police should come back to the door and interview people. It has to stop. Please do not send high killers to baby. It has to stop. Thank you. Thank you.
Good evening, welcome.
Hello. My name is Priya Gomez. I'm a San Francisco native. I grew up in the Vernon Heights neighborhood as well as the Fillmore. I am here to plead that you restore justice to San Francisco. I want to applaud Jim Kim for speaking out on behalf of and demanding and really saying that in this state of the perfect storm, I would say, we are at a place where, yes, this city needs police reform, but it also needs a good foundation for that reform to happen under. With Chief Suhr having the number of demotions that he had, is surprising to me that he has somehow made it to chief. It is appalling to me that with the amount of information that we have now heard over the last couple of weeks, including this blue ribbon panel, these findings around bias amongst the police department, that we still are at a place where we're not sure whether Chief Suhr will be fired. And I say that, you know, whether you are speaking in the best interest of the people of San Francisco or you are speaking in the best interest of the police commission and your reputation, we now have a huge distraction and an elephant in the room that we refuse to address. And that is that we have someone who we do not trust, whether it's now or ever, to implement these reforms that Ed Lee is promising with this new, you know, budget, this $17.5 million that he is seeking to bring into the city over the next 2 years. We do not believe it, that this is the right direction you need to go in to implement those reforms. And I really, really hope that you guys consider your power and position as the police commission to move forward on the request of the people, as well as Supervisor Kim and Supervisor Campos. Thank you.
Policies in a transparent work in this area, and certainly Director Hicks, and certainly you all know that a major, major problem is not your fault. The problem is state law. California has the most restrictive, has among the most restrictive laws in the nation that keep records of disciplinary proceedings secret so that people don't know what the findings are, people don't know what the discipline results are, and if you're looking for ways of trying to build up trust and confidence, this system is directly contrary to it. We can develop amongst all of us good policies, but if we don't have a system where people can see for themselves whether those policies are being followed, whether community values are being followed, we have to open up this system. And Mark Leno has had the guts, I think, to introduce this bill for statewide vote that would do exactly that, SB 1286. I just think it's absolutely critical for the seven of you, the commissioners in San Francisco, who are sitting here developing this policy to support this bill. You're part of the law enforcement community, and I hope Chief Suhr would support this bill as well, because I think it's really, your voice will be heard, and it's critically important. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker.
I have been speaking for a number of weeks and months about transparency also, and I want to compliment the department for last week taking a step, and they filed the charges last week with this commission involving, unfortunately, another incident of racist language and sexist language. They took the step of making that public, satisfying the officer's name, but making that public. And as I've said before, only good things happen from transparency, with long bad things happen from too much secrecy.
Right.
And immediately, even in the short term, it feels uncomfortable. The value of transparency is what has already happened in just a few days from this information coming public. Because we have seen the culture respond in all its horrible ugliness. And now the public knows what we're dealing with. And the public is in a better position to help you and help this department overcome. What I'm talking about is the Facebook posting of Gary Delaney, which has been reported in the Examiner. Now, some of us in this room can probably tell about a Gary Delaney story. Some of them might even be amusing. But kind of like Donald Trump, some of them are deadly serious. And this one's serious. Right? Now, he commented on this in his Facebook post. It was now in the newspaper, essentially broadcast to every police officer in San Francisco, saying that he didn't think this conduct warranted any discipline at all. That's fine. That's his opinion. Right? That's how free speech works. Somebody says something bad, the community stands up and opposes it. Right? I hope you will speak up on that. But more importantly, he said this. Talking about the incident, two other officers who heard the statement immediately raced to their supervisors and, quote, snitched him off, as our officers are now taught to do. Boom.
Right.
Boom. But when the former head of the DOA who has influence is talking about snitching and complaining about that, it is incredibly important that this commission, that this department speak up and say that officers will be protected, will not be intimidated. I compliment you for how you handled it when they tried to intimidate Sergeant Williams. She's a tough lady. She didn't probably need your support. I don't know who these two officers were. They did the right thing. They deserve
right, right, right.
But more importantly, unfortunately, it goes beyond that. Ray Marshall, who is attorney Shepard Mullen, former president of the State Bar, one of the most respected attorneys in the state, was reporting his part of the DA's panel report the other day, and he reported on the problem that there is, as he put it, they found that the SFPD is insufficiently independent from DOA.
Mm-hmm.
And to kind of illustrate that point, on Gary Delaney's private security website, who made these horrible statements, there is this testimonial. Delaney for 30 years. I've known Gary Delaney for 30 years. I would hire Barbary Code Security without hesitation for any security you need. Greg Suhr, San Francisco Chief of Police. Now, I understand loyalty to a friend, but you have a rule. In your policy, in your general order, says members shall not recommend to any non-city employee the name of any particular for-profit business when the member knows or should know that the member will directly or indirectly receive a benefit. That includes a political benefit. I will finish with this sentence. If a captain or a lieutenant or a commander did the same thing, you would not allow it. And cannot allow it because you're right. Thank you.
Like this. Gary Delaney is no longer a San Francisco police officer.
Gary Delane is no longer a San Francisco police officer. I have no say over what he says or what he does. I do think you pointed out an interesting thing that he noted, which is officers are now trained to, based on the Not On My Watch pledge that they took, that if you see racism or bigotry or homophobia or sexism, you are encouraged to notify your supervisor and an investigation will be done. And if that is found to be true, it will come before this commission. So I will assure any officer to back up what we already said on Not On My Watch, that any officer who does that will be supported by this commission. And I will say, I did get members of the community reaching out saying it took incredible bravery for them to do what they did. And that is, in fact, the culture change that we're talking about, which does take time, and part of changing that culture is illustrating that change, and part of it is when some people have a bad reaction. Also suggests that that change is happening. Yes, sir. Next speaker.
Daniel Mohammed, for the record. While you're taking time and people are being executed by the SFPD and people are losing trust and more trust of not only this commission but the city itself, as well as all the other government officials, including some of our weak supervisors who refuse to take a strong position and say that reform starts with firing the chief immediately. Now, this commission, which most people I talk to think is not going to do a damn thing properly, believes that you cannot have a city that you see like a damn Titanic ship going down, and you have the power to fire the chief, and the mayor has the power to fire the chief. Now, most of y'all who's handpicked by the mayor, if we look at over a time period, your positions you've taken is only support with the chief. So for us to really understand you all of a sudden want at this point, it's ridiculous. It's too late, and it actually proves that this commission here, we don't depend on this commission. That's why we're calling on a Department for Justice investigation. This chief worked at Bayview Station. The sergeant that was on the scene or worked out of that station, Mario Woods, was executed by on his watch. Give me a break. So we're going to really act like we're trying to be sincere now because there's a lot of pressure. And I've been volunteering for 20 years trying to get this department on track. So I don't need no lectures from new commissioners. I don't need no lectures from weak supervisors. I don't need no lectures from the sheriff department. I don't need no lectures from most San Franciscans because you ain't did the legwork that it takes to change the department. Now you sit in a golden seat. Use the little power that you have left. Otherwise, you will go down in history as being nothing but a hand-picked lapdog commission that signed off while people were dying. I'm not here to say what you want to hear. Mario Woods is already dead. We're calling on the Attorney General to investigate this department for the patterns and practices over nearly 40 to 50 years, and we can go back to 1850. So let's speak straight words and be real about what we're talking about here. You don't want protests. You don't want riots. You want reforms. You want changes. You want it to be a lovey-dovey conversation, dialogue, discussion, and speak over. You don't even have on your agenda to deal with this chief. You never post it on your agenda.
Right.
So you start with reform in a paramilitary structure by firing Chief Sir.
We should at least have bylaws. four taser incidents involved shocks directly to the chest area, despite explicit guidelines by the manufacturer to avoid firing tasers in the chest area, citing a risk of cardiac arrest. People of color are overwhelmingly represented in taser incidents, as you can guess. One study shows 68% of taser incidents involve black or brown people. Now, you say that in San Francisco, things will be different than in other places, that tasers will only be used in certain circumstances. Well, how can you give us a guarantee that they'll be used only in those circumstances? You can't, because they won't. They'll be used because the police officer has one in his holster and can use it. The misuse of tasers is going to be very expensive for the city coffers. We've seen district courts shell out millions of dollars, up to $6.2 million, to families of suspects who died after being tasered, and we're seeing it all over the state. I'll say Orange County, San Leandro, Salinas, San Jose, Riverside County. What makes you think there won't be police abuse of this weapon? Death and subsequent lawsuits.
Tasers and the use of force discussion, which is item number four.
So tasers later then. What I want to say isn't something, a new fact, but I'd like to remember, people to remember this. We say that the police is an occupation force in black and brown communities designed to terrorize people and drive them away. And one might think that this is rhetoric or not true, but I'd like to remind people of an incident on Martin Luther King Day in 2002 when police invaded a MLK celebration in Bayview. Right. These are police under Greg Suhr's command.
Right.
And they separated out a number of teenage girls and patted them down in a way that can only be described as groping. And the outraged parents said, "Why are you doing this? And how long is this going to go on?" And the officer in command said, "As long as you're here. As long as you're here." So I just want to reassure people that the day of the working class is going to come.
Entrances for people who had
a backpack, or it was crazy. I was told that the sign that I had, which was 11 by 7, was not the right size. Then I was told that I had written on it that Mayor Ed Lee doesn't care about us on the sign. And why make it so difficult? Let us come in here. There are probably people that want to be in this meeting right now that can't be here. Also, I wanted to say that, you know, I believe that words have meaning. And I know that over the past 3 weeks, people have been chanting this, you know, fire chief, sir, hundreds of thousands of people. Mm-hmm. Have you looked, Google it. It is becoming big. Just put in fire chief, sir. It's getting bigger. The revolution will be televised on Facebook. Yeah. It is with the young. It's getting bigger. My 14-year-old son knows about it. Okay? Fire chief, sir.
Thank you.
You guys familiar with that? It goes Proverbs 21, verse 7. Chapter 21, verse 7. The violence of the wicked shall sweep them away because they refuse to do justice.
Right. Good. Amen.
I'm going to say that one more time. I'm listening to God. Proverbs 21, chapter 21, verse 7. The violence of the wicked shall sweep them away because they refuse to do justice. Now, I was going to San Francisco. I've been here. I've been running around. I was just watching those kids that got kicked out playing soccer over there. Yeah, by the tech company. You see them? They're like, we brought paper. You can't play here. What happened to us, man? What happened to us? We was all kids. We was playing in the street, playing ball. Playing cops and robbers and stuff. We become victims of that. I'm just tired of it. I'm not here to shout at you or anything. We had the bat kid come here and, say San Francisco. Remember that kid? What happened? What's happening, man? Because I think he would be asking me some questions. I don't know. I don't want to get choked up right now. I'm just saying I'm tired of it. I'm tired. I know my people are tired. It's not fun to be out there yelling, and it's cold out there, we're yelling, we're angry. No, man, it's protect and serve. We need to start having a conversation where you guys show up once to school, not just once in a month, and give us a little ping, You got to start talking to us, Start talking, be like, how can we change this? But at this point, man, the numbers don't lie. You guys seen Seth Curry, right? Numbers don't lie, right? He was history, right? Anonymous.
What was it? Somebody help me out here.
Anonymous, right? The numbers don't lie. The numbers don't lie. The people have been killed in this city.
Right.
The numbers don't lie. You guys got a big Warriors flag in front of the city hall. What's up? I'm just saying. I don't want to go all crazy like that, but that's all I got to say. I'm tired of this. I didn't even plan to come up here, man. But once I heard him talk about spaceships and everything, I was like, all right, we got to speak up. Think about it. This is a historical moment. I know this is a last thing here. This city was people were looking for gold, right? Look for that gold inside of you right now.
Yes, that's
where it's really at. All right, forget all these skyscrapers and all these people trying to buy up with their paper. Crystal, what's up?
My concern is that these I would encourage you, by administering discipline, to keep that in mind. Thank you.
And my apologies to you if I offended anybody.
Any further public comment? Good evening, welcome.
Hey there. My name is Winston Sterling. I've been living in San Francisco for 9 months. I moved here to work for a tech company over to Google. Since moving here, I'm from Ireland. Since moving here, I've been astounded by the way that people treat the citizens. I follow closely. I think I'm going to be on the board up for no reason. I've seen the videos. And on Friday, my wife is a reporter for 48 Hills. And I saw the video of when she was beaten by the teeth. She hit and raised her original boots. And it's disgraceful to see some good people like that. I'd like to just have more. Thank you very much.
Have you reported the allegation of misconduct on behalf of the San Francisco Police Department? If so, the senior investigator can take your complaint.
The reporter, first of all, did all of the news and all the videos. And second of all, when my partner went and reported that, she was treated disgracefully like the thief. Like the way the thief treated when the victim goes in, she was questioned. She was asked to show her back by two males who spoke derogatory to her and basically made it sound as if her claims weren't that bad. So that culture of impunity, that way of speaking to victims, making them prove that they've done something wrong. And that's the strength, and I think it just shows the overall culture of impunity. During the Alex Nader trial, we saw people sniggering when the RDF was making their case. This is the general culture of just disrespecting people. In Ireland, the police are part of the community. The police don't go around with them. They're actually part of the community, and they're very well respected. But for some reason, I don't know why the police don't respect the people and why they treat people the way they do.
Value human life is in the statistics, how they time to make any type of decisions as to what this person had. Jump out the car, start shooting. Did he even have the, at that rate, he had his gun in his car when he was pulling up. 30 seconds, he had his shotgun in his hand while he was, pulling up. How do I respect people who are continuously violent towards us? And then when the Blue Ribbon Commission, they put their report out, y'all make it sound like the Blue Commission is lying after they put all this work in. So you're going to have a bunch of lawyers and judges, and you're going to paint them off as liars. How do we respect? Where do we respect? We don't respect. You reap what you sow. You got to reap what you sow.
Thank you.
You keep violent, but whatever you get back.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Next.
Go to